So there was the three questions were I'd mentioned that the two ways that the government and the authorities could collect was the trying to do sending in the sheriffs, and the other one was garnishing your wages. The second question was if I would argue that we need to bring in politics or organising, how do you do that? Thanks for that one. And the third one was an encouragement for me to ramble on about class. I will try and be brief. So the it's a very simple answer to the first one. So one of our successes very early on was that we shifted the whole, the kind of ideology, the dialogue, the way that people thought and talked about the poll tax. So despite the fact that the establishment in its entirety was against our strategy and our tactics, you know, say either they were for the poll tax or they said, you know, vote for your favourite political party and they'll repeal it, even though it's really evil, but carry on as normal. We were very successful in changing the popular culture to being one of complete opposition to it. So I say that's despite the fact that we got no support from any levels of officialdom in the media. One of that was immediately people started calling it the poll tax. As I said before, the official name of this tax was the community charge, which sounds kind of vaguely benevolent, vaguely all-inclusive, you know, a bit thrusty, community charge. So we immediately started calling it the poll tax, and that was almost immediately picked up by the mainstream media. So it was popularly referred to as the poll tax. No one called it the community charge. And again, as I said, we used that deliberately because it had these historical connotations. The previous poll tax had led to literally the peasants revolt and the king almost getting executed by the peasants. So such was that our success in using that kind of popular culture and changing the story, if you like, or the dialogue, that employers and the state, in terms of your unemployment money, didn't garnish anyone's wages because it was just too unpopular. It was not an option for them to do so. So it never, as far as I'm aware, no one did it because it would be too much opprobrium. How does one inject politics into one's organising? I mean, that's the million-dollar question. I mean, if I had the answers, we'd all be living in the, you know, communist utopia by now, because we'd have done it as opposed to doing it and failing. Nevertheless, I think looking back, we deliberately did not use any of our politics explicitly, deliberately. I say our whole method of organising was community organising, and we said we're your neighbours, and you know, we're against the poll tax, and we live next door to you, so let's organise that way. As I said, we didn't hide our politics. So every Saturday morning, I did a table outside of the local supermarket, you know, outside the equivalent of Safeways, and on that table there was information, you know, we're an anti-poll tax group, here's the leaflets, take a poster, put it in your window. I also had a vast array of anarchist literature on the same table. So again, I wasn't hiding my politics, but I wasn't injecting it. I think the important thing is to be more explicit without being domineering. As I say, I think we're very successful at getting people to step up and be organizers themselves. We didn't do any of the politics. So, I mean, there's two classic examples of this. I've got three very short ones. The British Socialist Worker Party, which is the British government, the ISO. As I say, because we hit upon the strategy of community organising, initially the organised left ignored it and ignored the poll tax. And the SWP, to their eternal shame, actually instructed their members to pay the poll tax because the opposition to the poll tax wasn't organised in the workplace. And hence the anti-poll tax struggle was a bourgeois deviation from the class struggle. And that was their exact words. So that's a really good example of how not to inject your politics into the situation. We had a lot of problems in dealing with the organised left. After 6 months, when anti-poll tax was the biggest game in town, SWP reversed its position and said, oh, you know, join them. So one of the problems that we had as organisers was actually fighting off the rest of the left. So what the left did, the organised left, which was the SWP and this group called Militant, who are another Trotskyist organisation, And they were actually the main problem because they were quite large and they were actually very working class, which will lead me into the talk about class. Meaning they were actually quite well organised, and they were organising in the same communities that we were organising in. But what they did was they basically tried to take over the anti-poll tax movement. So what they did is they first of all moved into our groups and tried to, you know, the typical ways people will pack a meeting, they'll, and we successfully fought them off. But in doing so, we came to that first issue, because for us, organising the way we did, horizontally in federations, we didn't have chairpersons, we didn't have secretaries. To us, that's just the way we did it, because we're anarchists, and it made sense to us, and it worked. But to other people, to apolitical people, or people who are not used to organising, that's not intuitive, that's not common sense. So we were fighting these strange battles, so Militant or the SWP would come to our meetings and would say, hey, why don't we have a treasurer and a secretary? And we were like going, no, that's a really bad idea, because we know why they're trying to do it. Whereas the other people in the poll tax group who are not political are like, oh, that's a good idea, yeah, let's have a secretary. So we successfully defeated them within our groups, but it meant that the aforementioned Edinburgh Federation went from the 9 groups that we started to 21 groups. So basically, because they couldn't take over our groups, they just set up their own fake groups. But in doing so, they then took over the Edinburgh Federation because they had more delegates than we did. And then in doing so, they took over the Scottish Federation. And in doing so, they took over the All Britain Federation. So what that meant is it was almost like a kind of dual power was going on. Whereas because we were still the activists doing stuff, we were, and to use the kind of cliched, horrible term, we were the power on the streets. So we still called the strategy and the shots, if you like. But it meant that we were, much of the time was spent fighting the organized left, because they were trying to recruit or sell their papers or whatever. You know, they were trying to benefit from the anti-poll tax movement. We were actually trying to have an anti-poll tax movement which could defeat the tax, if that kind of makes sense. And it meant that, you know, the poll tax federation would come up with all horrendous things, because again, remember, these people are closely allied to the Labour Party. So it's the Labour Party that's imposing the tax. So if one of our strategies in making the tax ungovernable was every time the local council would meet to debate or talk about the, you know, the tax, we would disrupt and destroy the council meeting. But it meant in real terms at Edinburgh, we were not only fighting our way past the police to get into the council meeting, we were fighting our way past militant stewards, Militant being this Trotskyist organisation, because some of the Labour councillors were militant. Do you see what I'm saying? So I say we were kind of on this weird, anyway, I don't want to get too much into leftist minutiae. But so to get back to the question about talking about your politics, it got really messy and complicated all round. But I think we did no job of explaining not only why we're organising tactically the way we do, but why the struggle against the poll tax is just part of this bigger picture and bigger struggle. And that we can't really win this bigger struggle without understanding that, if that makes sense. So I say, what that means in reality, of how would I do it differently? Well, I don't know, it's complicated, right? So that partly answers your question, I hope, about class, meaning that we're trying to organise the working class. Being a good organiser typically and often means that you know what you're talking about, but also that you actually have some relationship with those you're trying to organise. People, understandably, are very suspicious and often hostile to strangers, however that defines itself, coming in and telling them what to do. So in our case, we organise because we're your neighbour. You know, if you're working in Labour, you say, I'm your workmate, or whatever, right? Understandably. So class is really important because we're actually organising the mass of working class people, which is why the SWP, the aforementioned, were not a threat or a problem really, because they were largely organised students. I have nothing against students. I was a student myself once. But nevertheless, when you organise a mass movement, it's kind of largely irrelevant what students do. When you're talking numbers, when you're talking about 18 million people, most of them are not students. So class and class consciousness are vitally important for all kinds of reasons. but not least because it's our understanding of how people work, right? Class is vitally important because as radicals, as leftists, as Marxists, as anarchists, as communists, we actually, class is one of the main prisms of how we understand society and how society works. So to take class out of the equation, you've already lost your politics, right? But as we were saying, putting it into practice is tricky, because consciousness is a fleeting thing. Identity is a fleeting thing. It's ever changing. So my last example of that was the anarchists did fantastic work during the miners' strike. We were the only left organization that came out of the miners' strike with any credibility, because these other SWP or militant were, again, only interested in selling papers. So, you know, there's these massive militarized battles going on. Some of you may have seen footage of with pickets and the police fighting and all that. So the anarchists are actually there. We're in the pickets, right? And we're fighting, and there's pushing and shoving and violence, and the police and the military are battering heads. So there's these classic, you know, like Monty Python-esque scenes where we'll be running, you know, like being chased by these militarized cops, and there'll be someone going, "Socialist worker, buy your socialist workers." We're kind of like, as we're kind of running past, you know, being battered by the cops. But my point being, again, is not that we're fantastic. It meant that the anarchists were the only group that had any credibility after the miners' strike. Because of that, at the end of the strike, so on your little cheat sheet, there was this, one of the anarchist federations was called the Direct Action Movement, which is kind of like the anarcho-syndicalist, the more kind of trade union oriented, right? They again did fantastic work during the miners' strike. So at the end of the strike, many, many miners and miners' apprentices tried to join the Direct Action Movement. They came to us, actually I'm not a member, I was not a member. They came to them, us, whatever, the anarchists, and said, "We want to join you." And to our eternal shame, we couldn't handle it. Right? As it says in your cheat sheet, the Direct Action Movement at its height had about 120 members. And it didn't know what to do when 30 or 40 miners said, "I want to join your organization." Because again, these are not political people. So they're miners. They live in obscure rural communities. They are undoubtedly a bit racist and sexist. You know, they say words that are, you know, the language they use, the way they all. And as an organization, the Direct Action Movement, despite doing this fantastic work and having won their trust and blah, 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 didn't know what to do with these less than fully formed, perfect people who wanted to join their organization. So again, that's, if that talks a bit about class and the problems of politics and organizing.
Okay.
So as I understand the questions, there's one about the efficacy or not of universalism as opposed to class. What would be a good executive order kit, and what does empowerment mean? In terms of universalism, I say I'm not opposed to mobilizing. I'm not opposed to whatever works in one's toolbox, and there may be a place for permissions. Maybe a place for petitions even. There may even be a place for electing certain officials at certain points and certain times. I'm not ruling out any of that, but I think that is part of the strategy. And to have a successful strategy, you've got to have goals and vision. And I think those goals and vision can only be, I would argue, done through a kind of class prism. Which is not to say that class always trumps everything else all the time, always. But I think strategically and otherwise, that's the best way to organize. And I think that historically speaking, the campaigns that have tried to call upon that kind of universalist, we're all in this together, we're all human, we're all black, we're all white, we're all of this particular country, we're all of, have their limitations, typically failed. In terms of an executive order kit, again, I think that would really depend, again, on your strategy and your goals for the kit. I'm sure the ACLU have a very good particular set of kit and ways of how they're dealing with it on that kind of legal level. So again, it really depends to what end, I guess. What you want your kit for. What does empowerment mean is, again, another of these fantastic kind of like, well, what does getting political mean questions, which I will try and answer in a couple of ways. One is of how we actually empowered people, is we were very deliberate and very explicit of not being setting up a scenario which is more common, shall we say, on the left of having a leaders and a followers. We're not telling you what to do. We are helping you do it yourself. Or not do it yourself, do it collectively with lots of others. So we are empowering you to do that. We're not going to be the speaker at the meeting. We are going to train you to be a speaker. Mm-hmm. We're not going to write the leaflet. We're going to show you how to write a leaflet, how to produce a leaflet, how to. So in that literal sense, we were empowering people. But again, as I say, we really had to. You know, 30 people can't conquer 400,000 people in Edinburgh. I mean, by necessity as well as by our politics. But I think more importantly, it ties into that political thing of, again, of what, about politics and about winning, is that people are actually emboldened and empowered and educated by winning. And I'll give two quick examples of that, one in the British scenario and one now. My dear wife, who suddenly got really into Facebook and that kind of nonsense recently, which is very disempowering, I would argue, but nevertheless keeps coming up with various factoids. And one that she gave to me was that after the last week's protests at the airport, that actually opinion polls showed that people were more likely to be pro-refugee and welcome people after the protests. So that is a good way, or a good example, I guess I'm trying to say, of actually people being empowered by success and how that actually reverberates out into the wider community, or the people that are polled by pollsters anyway. That you'd think that the figures would actually go down, right, with all the kind of propaganda and all the thing that people would be, you know, the whole logic of the part of the Trump agenda is the same as, say, the law and order, right? The fear, these are not refugees, they're terrorists, whatever. And actually, despite what people thought of Trump and that idea, it got even worse because of the successful protests. And to parley back slightly, as I understand the protests actually went from mobilization to organization and disruption. Meaning people were first mobilized to go to the airport and they bore witness and they sang songs and they done stuff. My understanding, at least in San Francisco, is that the people detained were not released till they actually occupied the airport, meaning they made it, the departure lounge international couldn't work anymore. And it was only when they disrupted and applied that pressure and were empowered to do so, do you see what I mean, that they actually got the result they were looking for. So as a wider example of that in the UK context, remember I said the jingoism and the nationalism that Thatcher used by creating this war out of nothing made her the most popular prime minister ever, at least for a while. And that was a really scary times in the UK. Again, someone that was already politically active and organising, like the people pro the war, it was like 911 here, right? It was like, you know, off the charts, and it was really scary having the opposing opinion, trying to organise. You know, we were getting into fist fights. People were spitting on us in the streets in 82, you know, and we're like leafleting and organizing, and you know, we're picketing like army recruitment centers and the kind of things that you do, right? We were like, to contrast that, so the success and the general, despite what I just said about the politicization of the anti-poll tax campaign, the next big anti-war mobilization, well, there wasn't a big anti-war mobilization in 82 because we were insignificant in terms of popular opinion and numbers. The next one, as you recall, because it happened in America too, was in 1990 with the first Gulf War. Mm-hmm. And remember, 1990 is also the year of the poll tax in Britain and when it all came to an end. So it was the height of the anti-poll tax campaign. So to contrast 1982 in Britain and 1990, in 1990, it went from people spitting on us and getting into fist fights with people on the streets to, in Edinburgh, we were holding mass meetings, organizing against it. We were getting 300 or 400 people to our weekly open meetings. And those 300 or 400 people, which again was the mythical ordinary person, you know, there was clergy there, there was, you know, the usual whatever, Rainbow Coalition of 400 people coming to these weekly organizing meetings. Those weekly organising meetings accepted two slogans as their organising strategy in Edinburgh. One was No Blood for Oil, and the second was No War but the Class War. So that's how much in Scotland our organising efforts had shifted that wider, both the empowerment but also the whole kind of political consciousness, and hence your ability to do different and better things in terms of organising. I guess two questions which I guess are kind of the same. The first and the third, what's the potential for mobilising? Which I guess would be the same as disruption, more or less. And is that healthcare? And then, I'm not going to get into the efficacy or not of workers' parties, but I do think the class consciousness issue is a very important one. I think the potential for mobilising and organising and hence disruption is still going to be based largely around class issues. I think Occupy showed that. I think what Occupy was incredible for two things. One is it actually reintroduced class, albeit a really bizarre version of it, the 1%. Nevertheless, it reintroduced class into the popular discourse in America. And secondly, it was interesting because it actually mobilised all the activists, big time. So, which I think would actually contradict somewhat of what the gentleman said there about class consciousness in America. I think more explicitly, I think organising around healthcare, in particular Medicare and Medicaid, may be one of those universal issues because it does affect everyone, and it's also it's a kind of economic bread and butter issue, if you like. So I think in that sense, absolutely. I think one of the problems, I think there probably is more class consciousness, though perhaps not much anymore in the UK than there is in America. But that's because the Americans have done a much better job at erasing that. When America has a history of insane class violence and class consciousness, utterly insane, which puts Britain to shame. And really recent, 1830 to 1930. I mean, you guys all know some of the famous stuff, Haymarket, whatever, but you're talking about openly class warfare. You're talking about guns, you're talking about the American military bombing its own citizens, Blair Mountain, 1926. I mean, this is really recent stuff. An insane class conflict that meant that they had to make the New Deal. Mm-hmm. It was that a revolution. So Americans are as much class consciousness as much economic bread and butter stuff. I think the problem with Occupy was a great mobilization. It wasn't any organization. Okay. So when I'm trying to make this difference between mobilizing and organizing, I say Occupy was fantastic because it actually brought class back onto being the number one agenda. But it mobilised all the activists. It didn't actually bring in anyone else, which is what organising does, right? Organising brings in beyond the activists, right? So Occupy was fantastic mobilisation. And it was also a fantastic disruption insofar as it actually challenged the state because it broke the law, because it actually took physical space. And that, again, was a real kind of game changer, admittedly not for very long. But that was a real rupture in the way things are done. Well, I'm declining your generous offer to become your leader, but so to restate those questions as I understand them, they are all very interrelated. So what happened in the kind of gritty detail after the poll tax, and what did that mean for kind of the organising efforts as they were going? How do we actually maintain structure? And how do we build that structure? How do we build the infrastructure and the power to actually take organising forward? What do I think about that? And what is the magic solution to successful organising and creating the communist utopia? One of the myths on the left I mean, anarchism is part of the left. But anyway, one of the myths of the non-anarchists is that anarchists actually don't believe in organising and organisations. As I tried to posit, we were very well organised, and we actually had, in some cases, there was three national organisations, meaning they had membership and dues paying and blah, blah, blah. It's a different form of organisation, and it's a more horizontal form as opposed to hierarchical. And I still believe that not only is electoral politics is a real dead end in terms of organising, but I also, unsurprisingly perhaps to you, most of you believe that the kind of the vanguard party model is equally a bankrupt dead end. So having got that out of the way, I nevertheless firmly believe more than ever, and I think my experiences and reflections on the anti-poll tax struggle mean that you're not going to get anywhere without organization or organizations and structure. I said, my whole argument is we were so successful in the anti-poll tax movement, and we continued, for want of a better term, to be a vanguard, and we still continued, this tiny group of anarchists, to in effect steer it in the course that we wanted it to go, despite the best efforts of everyone else, whether it's the trade unions or the parties or the Leninist organizations, shall we say, because we were really well organized. So you're on both counts. So the solution to, as I see it, to getting the winning and getting those end results that you want is to be organized and to have organizations that can do so. Which leads to Kipps, one of the kind of, again, classic million-dollar questions is not just what form of organization best does that, but more importantly, how do you maintain that organization when there's not these exciting times of upheaval or whatever? The other million-dollar question, which I think people are hinting around, is then how do you use that organization to get the results that you want? So how do you intervene? How do you coalesce? How do you become part of? How do you engender? How do you help? How do you strengthen? How do you fortify the struggles, what's going on, to get the result you want? Stuff happens all the time, right? On a big level, on a tiny level. There's always strikes, there's always discontent, there's always stuff is breaking out, people are obviously really unhappy. I think it's, as I said before, it's one who's organized is going to win. And that's been the case, you name it. Everything we've talked about so far, every example that's been made, is because the people are organized and they've got organized to win. You know, is the Montgomery bus boycott structure of organization better than, you know, the class war anarchist federation? I don't know. But that's how you learn, right? Is by
what works,
what doesn't work, and if it doesn't work, you try and fix it and you build upon it and you learn from your mistakes. And But I do think that these are the crucial questions and that I've been wrestling with ever since. And I say, unfortunately, I don't have any concrete answers other than more of the same. I think it's vital that we build organizations. And I think without those, again, stuff usually happens because of crises, right? Because of whatever, stuff happens. And usually who's the best organized, whether it's on the right or the left or the state or whatever, how they respond to those crises or those disruptions or those stuff that happens is usually what's going to, you know. The right at the moment are really well organized. And so they're the ones that moved into this weird kind of vacuum / who the hell knows what's really going on with the kind of Trump administration, right? It's not some vast evil conspiracy of deranged lunatics, but they're actually exploiting the situation for their own agendas, right? And the left has relied on mobilizing only and the kind of moral outrage. Can you actually believe that Republican women voted for Trump, even though he's sexist?
Yeah.
Astonishing. You know, there's obviously something morally wrong with their character. I mean, wherever it is, you know, I mean, it's the kind of moral outrage and or mobilizing may or may not be useful and may or may not be part of that toolbox or part of the pieces of the jigsaw, but they're not the picture, and they're certainly not a strategy, and it's not a vision, and it's not a practice or a set of practices. Again.